Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to our worship on this sixth Sunday of Easter, which is also Rogation Sunday. There's been a couple of issues with people's broadband this morning, and I know certainly one of the readers isn't available because their broadband has crashed. And I'm not sure about the other reader because they're from the same place. So we may just have to get other people to cover the readings when we come to that, if those two individuals don't join us. But it's lovely also to have with us Canon Carroll this morning, who is going to preach and share with us from the Gospel, which is going to be really super. So you're all very, very welcome. And it's lovely to have you with us as we gather to worship this morning. We meet to worship God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, whose love for all creation is everlasting. Today we're thinking about how Jesus asked the Father to send the Spirit of Truth to live in all who love him, to be their comforter, to be their advocate, and to be their guide. We will begin by singing our first hymn, Alleluia, Sing to Jesus. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Alleluia. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Christ died to sin once for all, and now he lives to God. We are God's own people, called out of darkness into light. So let us confess our sins and joyfully receive God's promised mercy and forgiveness. Despite all our faults, God loves and cares for us and will not leave us comfortless. And so we turn to Christ to ask for forgiveness for our failures. For the times when we have failed to care for God's creation, Lord, have mercy. For the times when we have failed to keep God's commandment to love our neighbours as ourselves, Christ, have mercy. For the times when we have failed to love God, Lord, have mercy. In a moment of stillness, let's ask God to bring to our remembrance those things which need his healing and his forgiveness. And so we pray together. Heavenly Father, we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and have failed to do what we ought to have done. We are sorry and truly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and lead us in his way to walk as children of light. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on you and set you free from sin. Strengthen you in goodness and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And our collect for this Rogation Sunday. Let us pray that we may reign with Christ in glory. Almighty God, who through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, have overcome death and opened to us the gate of everlasting life, grant that as by your grace going before us, you put into our minds good desires, so by your continual help, we may bring them to good effect. Through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And we have two Bible readings this morning, and I'm just going to check to make sure someone's available to read those. And then after those readings, we're going to listen to a piece of music before Carol proclaims the gospel to us.
Yeah, I'm fine. The first reading is from the book of Genesis. Then Noah built an altar to the Lord, and taking some of all the clean animals and clean birds, he sacrificed burnt offerings on it. The Lord smelt the pleasing aroma and said in his heart, "Never again will I curse the ground because of humans, even though every inclination of the human heart is evil from childhood. And never again will I destroy all living creatures as I have done. As long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night will never cease." Then God blessed Noah and his sons, saying to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number and fill the earth. The fear and dread of you will fall on all the beasts of the earth, and on all the birds in the sky, on every creature that moves along the ground, and on all the fish in the sea. They are given into your hands. Everything that lives and moves about will be food for you. Just as I gave you the green plants, I now give you everything. But you must not eat meat that has its lifeblood still in it. And for your lifeblood, I will surely demand an accounting. I will demand an accounting from every animal and from each human being too. I will demand an accounting of the life of another human being. Whoever sheds human blood, by humans shall their blood be shed. For in the image of God has God made mankind. As for you, be fruitful and increase in number, multiply on the earth and increase upon it." Then God said to Noah and his sons with him, "I now establish my covenant with you and with your descendants after you, and with every living creature that was with you, the birds, the livestock, and all the animals, and all those that came out of the ark with you. every living creature on earth. I establish my covenant with you. Never again will all life be destroyed by the waters of a flood. Never again will there be a flood to destroy the earth. And God said, this is the sign of the covenant I am making between me and you and every living creature with you, a covenant for all generations to come. I have set my rainbow in the clouds, and it will be the sign of the covenant between me and the earth. Whenever I bring clouds over the earth and the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will remember my covenant between me and you and all the living creatures of every kind. Never again will the waters become a flood to destroy all life. And whenever the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant God and all living creatures of every kind on the earth. So God said to Noah, this is the sign of the covenant I have established between me and all life on the earth. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God. Okay. The second reading is from Acts chapter 17. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, men of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walk around and look carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. Now, what you worship is something unknown. I am going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by hands. And he is not served by human hands, as if he needed anything, because he himself gives all men life and breath and everything else. From one man he made every nation of men, that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he determined the time set for them and the exact places where they should live. God did this so that men would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him. Though he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by man's design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance. But now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to all men by raising him from the dead. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
Alleluia. Jesus said, all who see the Son and believe in him may have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. Alleluia. Listen to the Gospel of Christ according to St. John. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to his disciples, if you love me, keep my commands. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept this because it neither sees nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show myself to them. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. In enu tad amab arisbriglan. Amen. So, to cheer us all up in these lockdown days, we have a holiday postcard from St. Paul in Athens. Untroubled by the closure of airports or 14-day quarantine requirements or even police checkpoints at the Welsh border, today we see St. Paul enjoying the benefit of the Roman Empire's passport-free travel zone and taking some time out in Athens. Uncharacteristically at leisure while he waits for his colleagues, Timothy and Silas, we see Paul amidst the throngs of people wandering through the world-famous squares and colonnades of the Greek capital. With his backpack and his guidebook, he dodges the tour guides waving their little flags and presses through to admire the stunning architecture of temples and civic buildings, fountains and water clocks, colourful statuary and fine gold-lettered inscriptions all around him. The Areopagus of this postcard scene was, in effect, an open-access, open-air university where politicians and academics and thinkers of all sorts were free to pitch up and start a discussion. If they went down well, they would attract a crowd and could come back for days to engage in debate with whoever wanted to join in. If they offered something particularly intriguing, they might stay for weeks or months and maybe even attract enough of a following to start a new movement, of which there were numerous, some lasting, like the philosophies of the Stoics or the Epicureans. Some have disappeared unremembered into the mists of history. Well, after a day or two, Paul can't resist having a shot at this public rhetoric himself. And so he picks a shady spot under the corner of a temple roof, parks his backpack on the steps, and commences to address the free-thinking, cosmopolitan Athenian citizenry. Well, according to some of the more critical commentators on the Book of Acts, what follows might be described as the best sermon St. Paul never preached. The suggestion has been made that whilst Paul undoubtedly had a shot at preaching to the Athenians, it didn't go down too well. And what this polished passage really represents is what Paul realizes afterwards he should have said. Well, we've all been there, haven't we? Apparently, there is little evidence of a very early Christian community in Athens. And in the verses immediately after today's episode, we learn that when they heard about the resurrection of the dead, the main reaction of the Athenians was scoffing. And at that point, Paul left them. Although there are name checks for a couple of influential converts shortly afterwards. But whether it reflects his actual sermon or not, Paul's words here are an object lesson in how to approach a new audience, especially one which, just as in our modern world, is unlikely to be familiar with the background to the Christian story. No point in referring to the Hebrew Bible for a modern secular audience like Paul's in Athens. They wouldn't have been brought up on stories of Noah's Ark, learning to sing "the animals went in two by two, hurrah, hurrah," alongside "the wheels on the bus go round and round" when they were at playgroup. Standing amongst the shrines and temples to the numerous imaginary gods the Athenians worshipped, including to the unknown god in case they'd accidentally left someone out, Paul doesn't berate the Athenians for being sinners and ignorant idolaters, but respects where they are and builds on what their own traditions have already taught them of the truth of God and God's love for the world. Paul quotes the popular Greek poet Aratus in the opening lines of his best-known poem, Phenomena, which is all about the wonders of nature and starts off with a dedication to the chief god Zeus, which is what Paul quotes. Aratus was a writer in the Stoic tradition. And although that word Stoic has come down to us mainly to mean stiff upper lip, uncomplaining endurance, in reality, the Stoic philosophy was, and still is, much more subtle than that. Most significantly, Stoics had moved away from the belief that separate gods ran around on earth in human or animal form, causing mayhem or dishing out favors on a whim, and they were moving towards the idea that the whole of creation was permeated by a single, intelligent, divine spirit, which had brought all things into being and held them together, including human beings and human affairs. When Aratus dedicated his poem to Zeus, he wasn't thinking of the character in the myths who impersonates a bull or a swan and is famous for seducing beautiful women. Aratus is using the name of the chief god to express the universal benevolent force behind the whole of creation. Well, I must admit that all these years of this passage coming round in the lectionary with that line about "one of your poets has said," I never bothered until this week to look up what Paul was actually quoting and what that poet really said. But what I discovered was a very beautiful few lines, which I'd like to share with you. Let us begin with Zeus, writes Aratus, whom we mortals never leave unspoken. For every street, every marketplace is full of this deity. Everyone, everywhere is indebted to Zeus, for we are indeed his offspring. What the Stoics may have thought of as the world soul, St. Paul explains to the Athenians, is Almighty God, who in love sent Jesus, his Son, into the world to save us, and who is our Father too. In him, as St. Paul quotes Aratus, we live and move and have our being. If you love me, says Jesus, keep my commands, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you the Spirit of Truth. I wanted to play that piece by Thomas Tallis before our gospel, because apart from the fact it's sublimely beautiful, and why not take advantage of being able to use it in our worship today, it builds up to the punchline of those words, the Spirit of Truth. Thomas Tallis lived through the turbulent times of King Henry VIII and Queen Elizabeth I. And like many of his fellow composers and writers, he was originally a devout Catholic. Lots of what we now think of as the very prim and proper madrigals of that period, which were very popular with aristocratic amateur musicians, actually contain covert political messages supporting the Pope, and sometimes even cleverly coded into the music itself. So political sympathisers would be able to recognise one another by the songs they sang and the music they played. I think we can be pretty sure that even though Tallis managed to stay in favour with both Protestant and Catholic regimes, that emphatic repetition of the Spirit of Truth at the end of the motet was intended to make a point about the importance of sound doctrine. Truth is a slippery concept, as many proverbs and sayings demonstrate. Truth, it is said, is the first casualty of war. And it was Mark Twain who coined the telling proverb, a lie can be halfway around the world before the truth has got its boots on. At times of stress or conflict, such as the global pandemic we're living through now, fake news and false information proliferate. We've all seen the warnings not to pay attention to rumours about either cures or causes of COVID-19 spread by mystery friends of friends on social media. The term infodemic was coined by no less than the World Health Organization back in 2003 in response to the explosion of disinformation that accompanied the very first outbreak of a similar virus, SARS. Truth can depend on circumstances. Different and contradictory things can be true at the same time. It is true that for some, the lockdown is a welcome break from the daily stress of setting the alarm, commuting, and juggling work and home life. But it is also true that incidents of domestic violence have doubled, applications for universal credit and emergency hardship grants have soared, many jobs will be lost, and many businesses won't survive. It is true that many families have relished spending time in the garden and exploring the nearby countryside together, the air clear of petrol fumes and filled with birdsong. True that many families are confined to tiny high-rise flats, with city streets the only place to walk, parks and playgrounds closed. It is true that women are less badly affected by COVID-19 than men, who knows why. But it is also true that the virus has exposed all the inequalities we already know about. Worst affected are the poor, the elderly, those already in poor health, those in overcrowded living conditions, the Black, Asian, and minority ethnic populations, even after adjusting for the effects of poverty and household composition, and those in insecure and undervalued employment. Extraordinarily, the worst affected occupation has been security guards. It is true that the UK government initially advised that care homes were at low risk from the disease. But it's also true that it was genuinely believed at the time that the virus could not be spread before people showed symptoms, and that it would be easy to protect care home residents who stayed mostly behind closed doors. It is true that thousands more people are taking part in online services than ever come to church. But it's also true that we don't yet know exactly who those people are the same ones tuning into half a dozen services a day, boosting the figures, and whether or not they are existing churchgoers or newcomers. As Oscar Wilde said, the truth is rarely pure and never simple. St. Paul in Athens respected the truth which he found among the beliefs of the Athenians. The spirit of truth didn't cause him to start by expecting them to believe all the same things that he believed. He built on what they already knew. The spirit of truth led him to recognize that perceptions of truth would vary according to circumstances. But what was important was that people received the good news of Jesus. It's extraordinarily appropriate that our very first reading today from Genesis is the last part of the story of Noah's Ark. Gradually and cautiously emerging from the devastation of the flood, the vision God gave to the survivors for rebuilding their lives, their economy, and their society was one of peace, sufficiency, respect for all creatures, and for the environment. As we gradually and cautiously emerge from this stage of the COVID-19 pandemic emergency, we too, along with our governments, will have to consider how to rebuild our lives, our economy, and our society. We will have had very different experiences. Our truths will be different. If we too want a world of peace, sufficiency, and respect for the environment, we will also have to respect that not everyone has experienced things the way we have, and we must not assume that what suits us is best for everyone. May the spirit of truth enable us to recognize the truth that others see and bring to the world the good news of Jesus. Amen.
I invite you now to profess the Christian faith. Do you believe in God the Father, the Creator of all?
I believe and trust in God the Father.
Do you believe in his Son, Jesus Christ, the Saviour of the world?
I believe and trust in God the Son.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the Giver of life?
I believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit.
This is the faith of the Church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We're now going to move to Jenny for our intercessions.
At the bidding, Lord, hear us. The responses. Lord, graciously hear us. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Father God, we meet together this morning separately in our own homes, but united in our love for you and our desire to worship you, to give thanks and praise to you for sustaining us and upholding us in your loving arms during these difficult times. The God who made the world and everything in it does not live in temples. Help us to remember that your love and presence is not contained by the walls of our churches, but dwells in our hearts and minds. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Loving Lord, we give thanks and praise for the technology that is enabling us to keep in contact with our friends and family locally and further afield. And on this Rogation Sunday, when we would usually travel to other churches in our ministry area to celebrate and glorify you, we are still able to meet with the congregations from the other churches. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Caring Lord, we pray for Elizabeth our Queen, her government and all governments throughout the world, that they will work together for the good of all nations at this time to cure, contain, and ultimately eliminate this deadly virus from your world. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Loving Lord, we pray for your clergy who are ministering to us during these difficult times. We remember Archbishop John, Bishop Cherry, Reverend Kevin, Reverend Sheila, and members of the chaplaincy teams in all hospitals and care homes, who are working to alleviate the worries and concerns of patients in their care. For all staff working in hospitals, care homes, and in the community, doctors, nurses, and everyone working with and caring for people with any illnesses, not just this COVID virus. Give them strength and patience to care for those in their care. We pray particularly at this time for those from our own community who are suffering in body, mind, or spirit. May they feel your loving arms around them, comforting them. And thinking especially today of Claire Cooper, Patrick Harrington, Juliet, Lily, Gaynor Rees, and Jean. And we give thanks today for the recovery of Harry Beebe and Shirley Powell, who are both now at home recovering. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. For those in our hearts who have completed their time on this earth and are now free from pain and suffering to be with you in heaven, Father, today we pray especially for Graham James, Edward Card, Anna Tribe, Brian Owen, and their families and friends who mourn and grieve their passing from this earthly life, but rejoicing that they are with you in glory. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. In a moment of silent prayer, may we bring before you, our Heavenly Father, our own needs, concerns, and thanks. Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy on us. Amen.
Jesus said, "Those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them." We come now to the love and peace of Christ. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Alleluia. You might like to share the peace with those people who are with you in your homes, or just receive Christ's peace as you sit at home alone. And now we sing our next hymn, "Great is Thy Faithfulness." Blessed to you, Lord God of all creation. Thanks for your goodness, this bread we offer, fruit of our hands, fruit of the earth and work of our hands. It will become the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. Blessed to you, Lord God of all creation. Thanks to your goodness, this wine we offer, fruit of the earth and work of our hands. It will become the cup of life. Blessed be God forever. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Almighty and Eternal Father. And in these days of Easter, to celebrate with joyful hearts the memory of your wonderful work. For by the mystery of his passion, Jesus Christ, your risen Son, has conquered the powers of death and hell and restored to men and women the image of your glory. He has placed them once more in paradise and opened to them the gate of eternal life. And so in the joy of this Passover, earth and heaven resound with gladness, while angels and archangels and all the power of creation sing forever the hymn of your glory. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hear us, Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Through him accept our sacrifice of praise and grant that by the power of your Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be for us his body and his blood. Who, in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come in glory. Therefore, Father, remembering the saving death and resurrection of your Son, we offer to you in thanksgiving this bread and this cup, your gifts to us. And we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send your Holy Spirit upon all of us. Strengthen our faith and make us one. And welcome us with all your saints into the glorious kingdom of your Son. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours forever and ever. Amen. As Jesus taught us, we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. Lord, our hearts hunger for you. Give us this bread forever. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Each of us in our own homes, although we cannot physically take communion together, are united through the power of the Holy Spirit and made one with Christ. So we pray. In union, O Lord, with the faithful, at every altar of your church where the Holy Eucharist is being celebrated, I desire to offer you praise and thanksgiving. I present to you my soul and body with the earnest wish that I may always be united to you. And since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, I ask you to come spiritually into my heart. I unite myself to you and embrace you with heart and mind and soul. Let nothing ever separate you from me. May I live and die in your love. Amen. Let us pray. Bountiful God, whose Son Jesus Christ gives the water of eternal life, may we thirst for you, the spring of life and source of goodness, through him who is alive and reigns now and forever. Amen. May you know the Father's love for the whole of creation, the Son's love for those who follow his commands, the presence of the Spirit of truth within your hearts, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. In the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia. Canon Carroll for an inspiring and educational sermon this morning, and thank you for those who read and interceded on our behalf. I look forward to welcoming you to our midweek reflection led by Reverend Sheila on Wednesday at 10:30, and for coffee, virtual coffee and chat again on Saturday, and come together next Sunday, of course, at the same time for Holy Communion. Thank you all very much.